Tuhin Sinha, Amit Saha, Sumit Gupta, distinguished delegates and guests, thank you for giving me this opportunity to speak here on this very important occasion of Road Safety Week. Over the next hour, as we complete this session, India will have seen 55 accidents and 17 deaths on the roads. It's one of the world's most dangerous places to be out driving or just being out on the roads, crossing the street. And this is not getting any better yet. A lot of efforts have gone in, but the latest statistics that I have from 2015 and 16 show that there has in fact been a 3% worsening of the situation between 2015 and 16. I know many of you are familiar with these statistics, but it's worth dwelling on them just for a little bit to understand what this costs us. A life being snuffed out every 3 minutes on Indian roads is something worth pondering about. In terms of the cost to the nation, apart from the cost to families, to relationships, to society, has been estimated at 3% of GDP. That's a huge number. If we could curtail and contain our road safety crisis, we would today be a 10% GDP growth rate economy. That's a huge, huge number. It's worth spending a little bit of time on this. Another statistic that caught my eye is that our national highways constitute only 2% of the road network of the country, but claim 30% of the road accidents and 35% of the deaths from these road accidents. So you can see that the national highways are a core part of where we can make a dramatic difference. You know, if you start focusing on where the road safety crisis, how does the pie break up? You do a Pareto analysis, 20% of the causes, 20% of the areas will account for 80% of the deaths and losses. And that's where we ought to be focusing. Not that road accidents don't happen on smaller roads or state roads or village roads, but more than a third of them happen on just 2% of the road network. That's where a lot of the focus needs to happen. I can go on and on about the statistics, but as Tuhin said earlier, most of you are familiar with the statistics, and I don't think we need to spend too much time on it. I have had the privilege of being associated with a few road safety campaigns back home in Odisha and at the national level also over the years. I have in fact moved private members' bills in Parliament to try to bring about some of these changes that I will be talking about in a minute. But here, the purpose of this conference is to focus on what corporates can do. Now, this is a societal problem. This is a regulatory problem. This is an enforcement of the laws problem. But nevertheless, corporates can have a very big role to play. Corporates have the discipline. Corporates have the implementation ability. Corporates have budgets. And because of the legal requirements of corporate social responsibility, CSR budgets, there are a lot of things that corporates can do and are doing. If you look at the brochure, you'll see many corporates and other organizations have started initiatives, both through CSR and otherwise also. and you have heard certain ideas that Tuhin has spoken about, and I'm sure maybe in his closing remarks, Amit Saha may also mention a few things. I want to share an idea that it's not just about doing good for society. There has to be enlightened self-interest in corporates taking such a measure. My personal experience with road safety goes back to my days in when I was in college in the US, and my roommate died in a road accident. And those were the years in which, even in Western societies, the use of seat belts were still being scoffed at by many. And there were campaigns. There were campaigns run by corporates. There were campaigns run by government. There were campaigns run by automobile companies. There were campaigns run by organizations such as Mothers Against Drunk Driving, called MAD, to improve awareness and to improve road safety. And I think with the surge of automobiles on our roads in India over the past couple of decades, we are beginning to see the same challenges magnified manifold because we have the world's second largest population. Now, we've seen the corporate angle from a variety of ways, but I was most impressed some years ago when I was traveling abroad and I happened to meet an executive of a major global oil company. And I was quite intrigued when this person told me that they have a policy that whenever any of their employees is on the road, whether it is for official work or for private purpose, they must use seat belts. And if they don't, they would lose their job. It sounds a little odd. You're all from corporates. Many of you are from corporates. Just think about it. If you had a policy in your company that employees cannot keep their job unless they are committed to wearing seat belts when on the road, even when they're out for a private drive, nothing to do with the company. I was intrigued and I asked this person, who happened to be of South Asian origin, I said, how is this implemented? And this person said, well, in the first few months, it was scoffed at and some people didn't take it seriously until the CEO of the company actually sacked a few people, including a very senior vice president. And the message went out loud and clear that this is a company that is committed to road safety from the core of its beliefs. If a company is willing to enforce this kind of a belief system, it sends a message. It saves lives. And it helps communicate the idea that road safety is not just about your life. It's also about the lives that you could inadvertently take of other people, disrupt families, disrupt society, and impose a huge cost to the nation. It's easier said than done. I told you about losing a roommate back in college days. I've subsequently lost other people to road accidents. I lost a close team member from my team back home in my constituency who was in a road accident, again, not wearing seat belts. I tried to enforce among my own immediate team members the same kind of discipline that I mentioned a global company imposing, but it's not easy. In India, people don't accept discipline so easily. But this is something that corporates can do better because corporates, I believe, do have better discipline than many other kinds of organizations. I believe corporates have better discipline than government organizations, for instance. And these kind of things can send a message very, very effectively. I also appreciated the comment made a little bit earlier about corporates communicating that people, and especially their own members, can play a role in saving lives. And there was a mention of the Good Samaritan law. I think a lot can be done on that. For example, first aid training could be something that corporates could invest in. I think just like many corporates are required to have fire drills, are required to train their employees to react in a particular manner if there is a fire in the building, I think first aid should be a voluntary effort by corporates to train all their members, all their employees, so that should they find themselves in a situation where somebody else is in need of first aid. Because one of the critical problems that we have when we talk about these lakhs of deaths every year in India is that there is no medical care available immediately. It takes a long time, and the first hour is critical in saving lives. So imparting first aid training, not just to corporate employees, but corporates certainly can fund first aid training in schools, first aid training in colleges, first aid training in FICCI, NGOs. These are all measures that would, I think, help immensely. One of the smaller brochure for the schools mentions basic driving knowledge. Now, we know that there has been an improvement in India about the process of getting driver's licenses. In the past, you could just fudge it and get it. There is an improvement that is happening, but there is a long way still to go. I think with the use of today, you can actually have driver's training programs without people going out into the streets. Actually, have simulators. They're cheaper, safer, and at a very low cost, similar to having a video game in a video parlor where you have racing, road racing games. You can have driver's training setups. Corporates could fund that fairly easily. We are not talking many crores of rupees. We are talking only a few lakhs of rupees to provide these kind of simulators that can provide training, even to your own drivers, even to your company's own drivers, even to your own employees, and certainly to school children, college students, and others. I get stunned that every day out there on the roads, basic safety norms are flouted. People overtaking on the left. I have once or twice almost inadvertently hurt someone because we've pulled up to the side somewhere and tried to get out, and there's somebody overtaking on the left. Basic things of safety are not taught, which are there in that school brochure. These are things that corporates can help propound and help teach. It shocked me that, you know, about 77%, nearly 4 out of 5 accidents are due to driver's fault. 4 out of 5 accidents are simply drivers not obeying traffic laws or making a mistake of a certain kind. By the way, I'm a pilot and I fly regularly, and I see whenever I'm on a flight, on a commercial flight, for instance, a lot of people start praying, and some people, you know, get very tense, and it is intriguing because they're much safer inside an airplane than when they're in their car on the road. It's just look at the statistics. The chances of something happening to you on an aircraft are infinitesimally small compared to the risks of something happening to you if you get out on an Indian road. I'm not bragging as a pilot because I'm a driver as well, but I think we need to get messages like this out there that roads really are very risky in India. And that is something that is not appreciated enough. People think nothing of just getting in the car or getting on a motorcycle, not using a helmet, not using seat belts, and going out there driving irresponsibly. As I come to the close of my comments, I'd like to say that progress is happening. There are organizations like Biju's, which are doing a lot of good work. The Motor Vehicles Amendment Bill, which was passed last year in the Lok Sabha, does address some issues, such as third-party insurance and a few bits on road safety. But it also does not address many issues that activists have been raising about road safety. I think more can be done on the legislative front, on the regulatory front. But our basic problem is actually enforcement. Our basic problem is culture. To get people to obey traffic rules is a very fundamental requirement of society. And I would like to use the example of the oft repeated broken windows syndrome. It's a very famous case study in New York. Crime came down dramatically about 2 decades ago for a variety of reasons. One of the important reasons was a crackdown on basic, simple, lowest level laws such as jaywalking, such as jumping red lights. If you enforce the laws at the lowest levels, it has a cascading positive effect on higher level adherence to laws, higher level compliance to laws. A society should not be shocked if you have high level scams, if you have major scandals of laws being violated, if we routinely see ordinary routine traffic laws being broken all the time. That's the culture we are building in society. So it has a much greater impact on society than the 3% GDP growth rate cost that economists have estimated. I think the intangible benefits of the cultural change that we can have with enforcement and also by adherence culturally to road safety and to traffic laws is almost immeasurable. So to sum up, I think corporates can punch much higher than their weight class simply because they have the creativity, they have the budgets, they have the discipline, they have the ability to communicate, and they have the ability to enforce within their own networks, such as adherence to a seatbelt policy for all employees, irrespective of private or official driving. These are steps that corporates can do. I'm sure you will discuss and debate many of these ideas and many others that haven't occurred to us during the course of this event. And I wish you all the best to come up with ideas, but even more importantly, to start implementing some of these ideas within the scope of where you have the authority to do so. Thank you very much. Jai Hind.